In order to study the aerodynamics of finite wings, we need to first understand how the geometry of a finite wing is defined to make sure we're consistent. So let's go through a few different parameters here. This is a top-down view of a finite wing. And one of the first things that we're going to want to define is the span. And for that, we usually use the symbol b, little b. Okay, so span is b, and that's the length between one wingtip on the right hand side to the wingtip on the left hand side. That's the entire span of the wing. Now, if this wing was centered across the fuselage, then we might have a center line here down the middle where the span of each side is b halves. Okay, so span is equal to b. Another thing we need to know is the area, and the area is simply the what we call this is the planform area. This is the area that the wing would have if it didn't have any twist or dihedral, and we'll get into those in just a minute. But basically, this is the planform. This is the projected area if this wing were just laying straight on the ground. Okay. So, and we usually give that the symbol of S. That's the planform area of the wing. Let's see, a couple other things. We have a term called the aspect ratio. Let's see, I should have first defined this. So this is called aspect ratio. And the aspect ratio, I'm going to usually signify that as R sub A. That's a ratio. The capital R stands for ratio, and then the subscript is aspect. So it's a ratio, and this is the aspect ratio. Now, in the literature, a lot of times you'll see it, it's just kind of a convention to write it like this, AR, where they're combined like that. And I've even seen sometimes just capital A, capital R. But that can be confusing in mathematical equations where you don't know if that's capital A times capital R or an aspect ratio. Anyway, just to be clear, we're going to call all of our ratios with a capital R, and then what type of ratio it is as with a subscript. So the aspect ratio is defined, all of these are defined as the span squared divided by S. Now for a rectangular wing, for rectangular, then S is actually just the span times the chord, B times C, and then in the numerator here we have B squared, and so you can see that this for a rectangular wing just becomes B over C, and that's really the way to think about this. Is it's a ratio of the span of the wing to the average chord that you see on that wing, where we also need to define chord here. So chord is the same as the chord of an airfoil. We're going to use a C, and that is that length there from the leading edge to the trailing edge. Now C can actually be a function of the position along the wing, so it can be a function of the spanwise location. The way that I've drawn this wing, it just has a constant chord, but you can imagine that there are wings that could vary in chord, as a function of span. Anyway, so chord can be a function of that spanwise location, and in that case, then the aspect ratio is telling us this ratio between the span of the wing and a mean chord. So we would put a C bar above that if it was a non-rectangular wing. Same thing, but the way we compute that is just B squared divided by S, where S is the total planform area. Okay, so that's the definition of aspect ratio and chord. Now there's another ratio called the taper ratio. And we're going to call that R sub T. Taper ratio is really for wings that have a linear chord distribution. Okay, so so if our chord decreases linearly, then we'd have a chord at the root and a chord at the tip, and this would be a little t, a chord at the root and chord at the tip. Then the taper ratio is defined as the chord at the tip divided by the chord at the root. So it's roughly, you know, how much does this, does the chord change as you go from the root to the tip? That's the definition of the taper ratio. All right, a few more terms here we need to be aware of. The first here is sweep. So sweep is a measure, if I'm looking down on this airfoil, so this is, let's say that's the center line. Sweep is a measure of how much the airfoil gets swept back. Okay, so it's this angle here, right here. And we usually use a capital lambda for that. And there's actually a few different sweep angles that we might be interested in. The one that I've drawn here is lambda at the leading edge. So this is called the leading edge sweep. So that's the angle that the leading edge makes with the Z axis, if we use Z to be in our spanwise direction there. So I'll just draw that here. If that was a Z axis, for example, that's the angle between those two. But you also have the same type of thing here at the trailing edge. So lambda at the trailing edge. And we're going to find that it's really important to know lambda at the quarter chord. Okay, so this is lambda C over 4. That's the quarter chord location along the wing there. So this line right here would just go along the quarter chords all the way down the wing. Now, the way I've drawn it, they all look the same. They all look like the same lambda, but it turns out if you have a taper ratio, so for example, let's look at kind of an extreme case here. A fighter aircraft usually have quite a bit of sweep. So that's a nice fighter aircraft wing. So you can see that the sweep at the trailing edge is really quite small. The sweep at the leading edge is really high. And then the sweep of the quarter chord is something in between the two. So the reason we're interested in the sweep at the quarter chord, and that's what we're going to use most of the time when we're talking about sweep, we'll be talking about the sweep of the quarter chord, is because the aerodynamics of finite wings, I should say in incompressible flow, so below Mach numbers of about 0.3, they really scale mostly with the sweep of the quarter chord. The sweep of the leading edge and the trailing edge are nice for from a geometry perspective to know, you know, what does this wing look like, but the aerodynamics mostly depend on the sweep of the quarter chord, and that's because your quarter chord is very near the aerodynamic center of the airfoil sections, which you should recall from the from studies of airfoils, that the aerodynamic center is really close there to the quarter chord. And so how those are all positioned there along the wing is really important. And so that sweep angle is what kind of dominates the aerodynamics that we'll be studying. Now, one thing to note about sweep is that it's actually a skewing of the wing. It's not a rotation. And so if we were to slice the wing here, we would find that that's the same airfoil. The definition of sweep is that if we didn't have any sweep, we'd slice the wing along here and we'd have a certain airfoil. And as we sweep the wing, that airfoil does not change. It simply gets translated back by a certain distance. So this is really a skewing. You can actually think of it as like a stack of pennies. If you have a stack of pennies, and you were to slide each one a little bit behind the other, and I've laid this stack on the side, but you can imagine that's a stack of pennies on the side. That's what I mean by a skewing there instead of a translation. It's not a translation, it's a skewing, okay? So that's sweep. Okay, let's get into the next one, which is dihedral. And by the way, for sweep, we're going to use this symbol lambda, mostly dealing with lambda at the quarter chord. All right, and then so let's see, dihedral. Dihedral, if you were to look at the front of an aircraft, let's see that we're looking at it from the nose, you'd find that the wings generally are not just straight out like that. They usually have some, they're usually rotated upward slightly by an angle. So they usually have some angle here to the horizontal. We call that dihedral. Now, unfortunately, the traditional symbol for dihedral is capital gamma, which we're going to find is also important for measuring the vorticity or the circulation on an aircraft, or the vorticity distribution. And so capital gamma, we just have to be very careful about the use of that, because in some places we'll be referring to it in terms of dihedral, and in other places it will refer to the circulation. So anyway, we'll just try to be very clear of what we mean. But unfortunately, convention has kind of arrived at using gamma for dihedral, and for both of those two terms. So anyway, we'll just try to be clear about what it is. But this is, dihedral is actually a rotation. So I'll write here rotation of the wing from the horizontal. And so a vertical surface, for example, on a wingtip. So if we have some wing that's coming out here from the center line, and then sometimes we'll have this winglet on the end if we're looking at the front of the aircraft. A vertical surface has a dihedral of 90 degrees, okay? And so like a vertical stabilizer or the winglets, those usually are close to 90 degrees. Okay, so where sweep was actually a skewing dihedral is a rotation, okay? And now one last thing, I'm gonna actually put it over here because it's gonna require some room here to draw, is twist. So twist in a wing refers to the fact that if I draw at the root of my wing, my airfoil might look like that. At the tip of the wing, I may have a different, so I'll say that this is the root. At the tip, I may have a different airfoil, or that airfoil may actually be twisted. So let's draw it a little bit twisted from where it was at the root. Let's see if I can draw this. So here's the airfoil at the tip. And the amount that has been twisted from root to tip would be called the twist in the wing. Now, twist can also be a function of the spanwise location. So we can have more complicated twist distributions, but we'll be talking about, for example, linear twist, where it just linearly increases in twist from zero at the root to some finite value at the tip. That's a very common type of twist. So we'll be talking about that quite a bit, but in general, that twist does not have to be linear. Now, there's actually two different kinds of twists. What I've drawn here is called geometric twist, and that is actual rotation of that airfoil as you move out. There's another kind called aerodynamic twist. And an aerodynamic twist basically is, let's draw our root airfoil again. Maybe at the tip we have a similar airfoil, and it's not geometrically twisted, but it has more camber. Okay, so let's say that at the tip we have more camber there. What that does is it actually changes the zero lift angle of attack. So if the root section has alpha and CL, looks something like this, and this is the zero lift angle of attack, by having more camber at the twist, we've changed the zero lift angle of attack, at the tip. And so that essentially, it has a very similar effect to geometrically twisting the wing. We've just done it by aerodynamic twist, by changing the zero lift angle of attack, or the camber of the wing. Okay, so those are two different kinds of twist. We have the geometric and the aerodynamic. So these are the main terms that we're going to be using to define the geometry of our wing. We'll be referring to these throughout, and so hopefully that's clear to you.